Go for it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I speak English, a little Spanish, not much, but just
not much. You don't need to.
Anyway, I want to know where you got your charisma from, your backing, your what's your favorite food, Mexican food?
Gosh, you know, I'll tell you where I get my backing. It has to be come from my great-grandmother. I was raised by my great-grandmother, and may she rest in peace, and then my grandmother. But very few of us get to be raised by our great-grandparent. That's a whole different world when you get raised by that kind of wisdom. It is different. I mean, I got to tell you, I'm 65 years old. I want to be a great-grandparent. I'm already a grandparent, so I'm just trying to stick around now. I have my oldest grandchild is 8 years old, so I have at least, God willing, another 20 years before she decides to have one. But whenever it comes, because I remember what happened. And I remember what went on with me and what my life was like. And it started with her, and then goes on to my mother, and then goes on to my dad and the male side of my family. But I got a real jolt of my woman side right from the beginning, and it really does make a difference, you know.
Yeah, you're so gentle, but forceful. You know, the gentleness shows out first, and that's neat.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Your favorite food?
My favorite food. Oh, my God. Japanese food.
No, Mexican.
And Mexican food, my favorite Mexican food. My God. I would have to be frijoles de la olla.
Okay.
Just plain beans with the soup, not refried.
Yeah.
With onions and cilantro and tortillas,
right.
Guacamole, chile.
Thank you.
But they're beans. I like beans. It's the best way to get your protein, man. There's no better way. Hello, darling. Miami Vice T-shirt. I love you.
Yes, yes. We just met a little bit earlier, and I've enjoyed that very much. And it was very interesting hearing how you created the Castillo character. And, of course, as you said, you mentioned that you have influence with all your characters. But when you did Galactica, this was a character that had been originally, even though in a different treatment, portrayed by another iconic actor, Lauren Green. Did you find that daunting, or did that influence you at all, or what kind of did you think about
it? It was
that?
A reimagining of the entire show, so I really didn't lock into anybody's characterizations in that show. It was like it was going to be. I went back and I watched Blade Runner to make sure that I remembered well. If you put in, at the end of Battlestar, the final scenes, which some people in here have not seen them yet, but in the final scenes, you know what happens. And when it stops, when Battlestar goes to black and the movie's over, just pick up Blade Runner and stick it in. It's the continuing story. Matter of fact, even Adama's direct descendant, 200,000 years later, is Gaff. He even looks like a younger version, but it's really far out. So, yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hello, Mr. Almos. My name is Jacob Alisha. How are you doing today?
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, first of all, to coming to Kansas City. We really appreciate it. My dad is a big Battlestar Galactica person. Fan, and unfortunately, he's not here because he had another prior engagement. But he told me to ask this question for you: which were the most difficult scenes to film while you're on Battlestar Galactica?
Oh boy, there was a lot of them, and I think they kind of resonate in everybody's mind because at the time, the death of Starbuck, the understanding when Starbuck tells me that she actually was responsible for the death of my son. The moment when I find out that Colonel Ty is Cylon. Those are moments that just crystallize in my brain.
Spoilers.
If you haven't
seen it by
now, guys.
coming at you. Oh, man, if you're sitting in this audience and you haven't seen that, And you don't know about that? You should know about that. Because I got to tell you, man, it's very, very difficult. I mean, it was the hardest realities I've faced on camera yet. And, you know, it was just really, you got to remember the show itself. When you think about what it is that we do, the art form that we chose to do, storytelling. When you're telling a story and you really are trying to make sure that you're saying the truth about that story, that story, you know, there's no five words in the world that most grab the ear and the imagination and the people than if I'm looking out at the audience and I see people are like tired or floating or, you know, looking at their watches or, you know, talking to each other, I go, let me tell you a story. And they all go, bing. That's the magic of true magic. You want to captivate an audience? Just say, let me tell you a story. And all of a sudden, everybody goes, yeah. And that's what we're doing. We're telling stories. And so the story that we told was the annihilation of us as human beings by our own creation. Sound familiar? Does it resonate today even clearer than it did like 5 years ago when you were watching the program? Aren't we closer now that Israel's getting very, very uptight about Iran or Iraq? Iran. And that they're going to probably nuke that part of the world? I mean, come on. I was with Shimon recently. I pray that those people can sustain the discipline and the patience to allow people to discuss and talk their way out of this one and get these people to stop whatever it is that they feel that they have to stop. I don't want anybody to nuke anybody for any reason, because as soon as one goes off, it's going to be a compounded fracture on the planet. In 1950s, I'm 65 years old. I know I look good, okay? But I am 65. I am the new 30, okay? I'm in midlife right now, and I feel it. Now, even though I wear this, you know, this like high style, huh? Hey, man, Edward James Olmos with a scarf. Actually, I dislocated my shoulder. Yeah, 6 weeks ago. And I'm supposed to have it in the sling, but, you know, I kind of feel like self-conscious of having it in the sling. It's okay. I mean, dislocations are great once you relocate them. So, I got to tell you, where we're going now in this world that we're faced with is unbelievable. So all I can tell you is that we told stories. The story that I told was monumental. It was monumental. And even how many television shows have ever been in front of the UN? I mean, did anybody see the UN when we were at the UN? Anybody raise your hand? Okay, I advise you to go on Edward. Just put Battlestar Galactica at the UN, or put Edward James Olmos at the UN, and watch what happened. We actually spoke in front of the entire chamber, and we did it for a reason. Because they wanted to know, they wanted to show the rest of the planet, the whole planet at one time, with, by the way, a pop art, I mean really popular art form of television. And they chose us because we talk about, you know, a reconciliation. That's what they try to do. We talked about children in war in our show, which they... every day they face this. That's what they do there. So they used our show. They show clips, and then they would talk about how they have to deal with, you know, suicide bombings, you know, right to life, right to choice. You know, that those issues became almost unbelievable because people had a real hard time. I mean, can you imagine all the right to life people when they saw that program, and they had to sit there and go, you know what? The admiral's right. I mean, they can't allow any human beings to pass. We need every single baby. Matter of fact, I stand up and I go, we got to make more babies. You know, it's true. Now, are we overpopulating this planet? Yes. So I understand the difficulty. But that comes through, I think, education. I think we need to know what the outcome is going to be, and we have to tell people what the outcomes are. And we have to educate people on the planet and let them make the choice. People say, well, you really can't do that because people are not going to really do the right choice. Uh-uh. I don't believe that in one second. I believe that once you know what the right thing is to do, you'll make that choice and you'll do the right thing. For yourself, maybe. For your family, second. You know, hopefully you'll be a wise, you know, selfish person. A foolish, selfish person is a person who wakes up in the morning, says their morning prayers, makes sure the family's okay, goes off to work for 10, 12, 14 hours, comes back, makes sure the family's okay, says the prayers, and goes to sleep. That's a foolish, selfish person. A wise, selfish person gets up in the morning, and says their prayers, makes sure the family's okay, go off 10, 12, 14 hours, come back, make sure the family's okay. They just before they say the prayers and go to sleep, they look out the front door and they make sure that their neighbor's okay, and that this neighbor's okay, and that this neighbor's okay. Then they shut the door and they say the prayers and go to sleep. Be a wise, selfish people. That's all.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Go ahead, man.
I just recently got into the to the show Battlestar Galactica, and just the last month and a half, I've that's you. Make no mistake.
For those that don't know who you are,
who am I?
So, I've just recently gotten into the show, just about 6 weeks ago, and I finished it. I've seen the entire. It's ridiculous. It's a fantastic show. I wish that I had seen it, but I kind of like now that I didn't have to the suspense of it.
Oh, you saw it the best way. Most of us in here saw it your way, by the way.
Oh, okay.
Not very many of us saw it on sci-fi.
Well, I was been watching, I've been reading a lot about the news with Battlestar lately, and just saw that Blood and Chrome, they've decided they're not going to pick up for a full series. But with that said, when I was also digging around, I read that you at one point in time had said you were going to work on a graphic novel to continue the story.
Oh, I would love to do that. I mean, I would love more than anything. I've been talking to, some of the, Bob Layton and these guys, just about. Bob's writing a screenplay for me at the present time. We're working together on peace with my son. But, I would love to do. I'd like to know what Adama is doing right now. That's all.
Absolutely.
You know, it's been 4 years since we left off. What has he been doing for the 4 years and where he was, Good luck, you're at the top of the mountain. Now where are you? just like to know what's going on with him, that's all. I think that's a hell of a story.
Yeah.
And where he was located, because I don't want to be the spoiler, where he is and what happened to him and what's going on with him, and now what's going on with him right this second. I would love to. I don't care where you choose. You could choose right after the moment that we left them, or you can go 5 years later, or you can go 10 years later, whatever you want to do, but just from that moment on, boom, now he's in this world, and we all know about that world a little bit, okay? If you're an anthropologist, you know a lot about it, but basically, what a spoilers we're giving. I mean, that's terrible. Don't say any more, man.
No, I'm good, but thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Mr. Olmos. I'm
Hello,
Chad,
sir.
From Tales of the Smoking Chihuahua podcast, and anyway, I've got two quick questions for you, please. Number one, how difficult was it for you and the rest of the cast to learn all that sci-fi Dreadus lingo that you were spouting around the CIC all the time? I mean, how many times did you have to practice all that? And second, in a lot of episodes, you and a lot of the cast were fall down drunk a whole lot by the bar. What were you actually drinking during those scenes?
Wasn't good. In actuality, the drink itself was terrible. I mean, they would just get like Coca-Cola, flat Coca-Cola, and put water in it, And then they put green tint on it, green stuff, and it was just like, oh my God, do we have to drink this stuff? But it was great. It was just fantastic. It got you drunker than a skunk. It was amazing what happened. If you stop to think about what really we showed. I mean, I don't think I've ever seen a hero of the nature of Adama hit the skids so hard, and really jeopardize himself and everything, because he went to the bottom. he was popping pills and getting drunk or skunk. He couldn't even stand up, you know. And that the whole juxtaposition between him and the colonel, you know, what the colonel went through, and then what you know, you and then, you know, it was a fantastic understanding. And I'm glad that they allowed me to do that because they didn't know I was going to do that. You know, they didn't know I was going to start drinking. And all of a sudden, they looked at the dailies. The writers looked at the daily and goes, oh, the guy's really, man, he's drunk. I think the guy's drunk. You know, and so, you know, so when I was hitting the bottles and starting to do that and I was breaking down, I just needed the arc. I didn't want to be that guy that just kept that same, always this the tough, you'll make it through, don't worry about a thing kind of guy. Yeah, I just said, that's like bullshit, you know. People crack, man. I mean, they do. I don't can't tell you how many colonels, how many admirals, how many people in high ranks in the United States Armed Forces have come up to me and said, thank you. Thank you. Because I allowed them to see themselves in their most weakest moments. And they knew that they've had them. But when they go out into public and they're talking to people and they're commanding, they can't show it. You know, but in the recesses of their brain, as they're sending out our children and our brothers and sisters into battle, and they're just getting annihilated, and you know, for what? And we wonder, and you know, that becomes the issue. And so, for me, I felt bad for these people. You know, I really do. And I wanted to make sure that if there was an escape valve that could be used in this situation, this would be it. To show him, I mean, when he's groveling on the ground, and he's like, right before he paints his entire bathroom and repairs it, because you know, he comes into the place and just completely loses it, and then of course I already talked about Ty, but when he finds that out, and then personally he just like his son comes in and tries to, I mean, nobody knew I was gonna, I directed that scene, so how were they gonna know I was gonna do it?
Awesome. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. I'll never forget trying to tell the crew, okay, guys, you ready? Okay, what are you going to do? I said, watch. Just film it. Okay, it'll be on at 7. It's so much fun because they're like watching. No one knew, you know. We don't rehearse that stuff. You know, that's what the beauty of it. Those are the kind of things where when you felt an impulsive, like, almost like if it was happening for real, like a documentation of what was going on, it was. Because our camera crews were so strong and they were really understanding of the fact that, hey, we might show you where we might end up at, but I'm not going to show you how I'm going to get there. But if you need my location, the last place I'm going to be at, I'll be here. But to get here, I'm not going to show you it right now. I'm going to do it. So are you guys ready? Is everybody ready? Okay, action. And you go and you do it. You know, I only did the scene with Kara, you know, when she tells me about my son. I only did, how many times are you going to do that? You know, how many times, remember the ship, the notorious ship that cost like $200,000? It was a classic that I broke, shattered it. No one told me it cost that much. Boom! Oh!
What happened?
What? What happened? One of a kind. Oh. Oh, shoot. Oh. I guess it's kind of like ruined, huh? Yes, Ed, it's ruined. I said, well, what did you put it in the scene for? I mean, God almighty, I'd just been told that my daughter's dead, you know? What are you, nuts? But that's what I mean. That's kind of stuff that was happening all the time. And so that's really what made the movie, what makes it work. It's almost like a documentation of human behavior. It's the closest we can get. It's an aesthetic that I've been working under for the last almost 35 years, 36 years. I learned it from one of the directors of our movie was Robert M. Young. He directed Dominic and Eugene. He directed me in Caught. He directed me in Triumph of the Spirit. He's directed me in about 30 different pieces throughout my lifetime. We've worked together for a long, long time. We're working on a piece right now. He's 88 years old right now. And he's right now developing our next piece. He's writing our next piece, and we're both co-writing it, and we're both going to co-direct it. But his aesthetic is such a pure. He's the man who invented documentary journalism in the 1940s and 50s for television. And he's a brilliant filmmaker. And so his aesthetic is the one that permeates our show and gave us a lot of the feeling of the show. He came in on the 8th show. He should have come in on the 2nd show. He should have done Water. I begged them to let him do Water, but they went another way, and that was fine. But because the aesthetic would have been placed quicker into shape. So anyway, but that's the feelings that you get.